Hey everyone, Dan here. Now, I would have played November Rain by Guns N' Roses right now, but I can't be asked to edit in because I need to get this video out really quickly. But the punchline would be, it's the November film ranking. We are nearly done with these monthly film rankings. This is the penultimate one, and this is a pretty stacked one, so I'm not going to waste time in this intro, but we've got a lot of iconic films that you all heard of, a lot of Wes Anderson films, and also as well, four movies on this list rated 10 out of 10. That's the most 10 out of 10 movies I've got on any of these lists. But a few things. First of all, I've actually seen two of them before, so I kind of know I love them, so, you know, there's that. Secondly, it's just my opinion, so I don't really care if you think I'm too generous. And also, it just makes it a bit different, you know. I'm not, you know, I get to be more positive, you know, so that's always a good thing. Anyway, let's get on to the video.
You've dabbled with aliens, now meet the genuine article.
Plan 9 from Outer Space is often touted as one of, if not the worst film ever made, and it's very easy to see why. It's the most corny, cheesy 50s B-movie about alien invasion, and it's also about vampires. I don't know how you get from aliens and vampires in the same film, but sure, knock yourself out. I mean, Ed Wood, the director, you know, bless his heart, he tried to make this big, epic, grand-scale sci-fi story about the dangers of nuclear weapons. It's sincere, but nothing about it objectively works. Campy acting, dreadful sets, awful effects, even for the 1950s. I mean, who could forget such iconic moments as the ridiculous aeroplane cockpit set and the church that genuinely looks like a portaloo. I mean, Stanley Kubrick, he's probably creaming himself watching this and the meticulous craft that went into this amazing, amazing motion picture. Now, it's kind of novel to check out one of the, you know, one of, if not the worst film ever made, often touted by critics and whatnot. And there is definitely ironic appeal in this film. There is definitely that. But for me, if I'm being honest, it did kind of wear off, like, about half an hour in, and I was honestly left bored after all of the infamously bad moments sort of first came in. I just found it really boring and just, I didn't enjoy it. Now, comparing this to some of the other bad movies I've watched this year, I mean, it's, you know, it's not as offensive as Rain Man, it's not as boring as Fear and Desire, it's not as forgettable as In the Earth, but ultimately, I can't really rate it that highly, because it is ultimately just crap. The Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou is currently my least favourite Wes Anderson film, and it's the one of his that really epitomises why I don't massively care for him as a director. It's the overly quirky nature of the film for not much of a real reason, and it's just there for the sake of it, and it honestly kind of feels pretentious, and it does rub me the wrong way, to be honest. Now, don't get me wrong, there are some good elements to the film. I like the Portuguese David Bowie covers. I like Willem Dafoe in his silly German accent. I like the random pirate bandit action scene. That was kind of cool. And the part at the end when they're in the submarine and they meet the shark, that was actually a really cool scene. I really like that. But for the rest of the film, I didn't care for it. I mean, the overly quirky, funky sets and the costumes and all the quirky characters, it really didn't connect with me. It just felt like it was there for the sake of it, and I don't connect with the film in that way. I think a real letdown for the film were the main characters. I didn't really connect with me. I mean, Steve Zissou himself, played by Bill Murray, I didn't really care for, and I didn't really care for Bill Murray's performance either. It didn't feel deadpan like most Wes Anderson films. It just felt kind of dull and disinterested. And Owen Wilson, who plays Ned, who's another kind of key player, didn't really care for him, and also his ever-changing accent just drove me up the wall. And there's some really, like, conceptually hard-hitting emotional stuff towards the latter half of the film with those two characters. And I've got to be honest, I felt nothing. So that tells you a lot about how much I cared for the film. But the real kick in the knackers for this film is the length. Most Wes Anderson films are about an hour and a half, 100 minutes. This is 2 hours long, and it doesn't half drag on. It really does, and I just, overall, I just didn't enjoy this film, plain and simply.
We're going back in time to the first Thanksgiving to get turkeys off the menu.
Free Birds is not a very good film at all, but it's also just peak cinema, and it's kind of the better Plan 9 for me. This is a film that I do genuinely get a lot of ironic enjoyment out of. It's a bit of a guilty pleasure film, even though I know for the most part, it's not very good. It's a dumb premise. I mean, the meme line says it all. It's about time-traveling turkeys going back in time to the first Thanksgiving to get turkeys off the menu. And there's just wacky hijinks, and they go to a government base, and the Owen Wilson Wee House and turkeys go back in time, and they get with these, like, turkey gang, and they're trying to stop all the mean people who are trying to kill them and all that. And the Owen Wilson turkey gets a boner for the lady turkey, and it's just a completely bonkers film. It really is. I think it really is that bonkers premise that does save the film and give it a lot of meme material, and mainly in the first act, some genuinely funny moments. I think there are some actually decent jokes in here and there, but overall, if it weren't for that, I mean, the animation's pretty mediocre, the voice act isn't the most spectacular, the second act is really boring. I genuinely forgot half the things that happened in it until this rewatch. It's just, it's such a baffling film, but I do genuinely enjoy it, and the humour, oh man, just, oh, it's so funny, it's so funny.
And that's Paul, he's getting a divorce.
Yay!
And that's a bald guy.
And that's the girl who likes my daddy.
How could this happen to me? I'm made.
You want to rob the bank? Then you queue up like everybody else. I've got a gun!
Bottle Rocket is Wes Anderson's first feature film, and I kind of take back what I was saying about the over-stylization of films like Life Aquatic, like French Dispatch, because this film is just the most generic, bog-standard crime film ever. And, you know, Wes Anderson films, love them or hate them, he has a style, he has a voice, a very unique voice, of what he wants to say with his films. And I can respect that even if it's not necessarily my cup of tea. But with this one, I don't get a sense of anything that he's trying to say, except maybe the whole character arc with Anthony's self-discovery. And I'm a bit hesitant to say that, because it ultimately feels quite surface level. Like most of the film, it's fairly standard, except for maybe the odd fun sequence here and there. You know, there's the nice bit of cinematography here and there. The acting, mainly from the Wilson brothers, I think is pretty good for the most part. And the humour can be quite good at points, but overall, I just don't have that strong feelings towards this film. And that's a bit of a disappointment, really.
Go back to Paris! Oh.
I wasn't in Paris.
So, Plan 9, Free Birds, and now Mr. Bean's Holiday. That's three films already to tick the outlandishly silly box. I swear I didn't mean this to be intentional, but that's just how things ended up. Anyway, Mr. Bean's Holiday is definitely the best of this outlandishly silly trilogy on this list, and it's definitely the only objectively good one. It's not groundbreaking, it's not that, but it is very fun. It's simple, but it's charming, it's endearing, and it captures the spirit of the original Mr. Bean sketches with the kind of simple but fun slapstick humour. It's got a simple but fun premise of Mr. Bean just mucking about in France for a bit, and it's quite fun. And I will say, as a film fan, seeing Willem Dafoe play this pretentious film director and have him, like, the kind of final act of the film set at the Cannes Film Festival, I thought that was quite funny, and I really enjoyed it. And overall, like, it's nothing groundbreaking, but it is just a nice little cozy, fun, humorous film, and it's just fun, really, just fun. If you like Mr. Bean stuff, just check this out.
In a little while, we're going to see a short clip from
Killers of the Flower Moon.
It's 88 minutes long.
Killers of the Flower Moon is Martin Scorsese's latest film, and I was fortunate enough to go watch it at the cinema, and it was great to experience, you know, films that aren't just blockbusters and, you know, these auteur directors. It's kind of cool to see. And Killers of the Flower Moon was really great. I think it looked fantastic. Scorsese hasn't lost a thing when it comes to directing the visuals, the cinematography. I think it just looks beautiful. I generally just love the 20s aesthetic that this film goes for. I mean, there's some, like, silent movie sections where they convey exposition, and I thought that was really cool. And just, I love the visual storytelling of this film. I think the performances are really great. Leo DiCaprio, Robert De Niro, Lily Gladstone, I think they're all fantastic in this film. And there's some really dark, disturbing, and quite heavy subject matter. And obviously, it's depicting real-life events with the murders of the Osage community back in the 20s in Oklahoma with the discovery of oil. It's a very noble thing to bring awareness of, and I think it's done very respectfully, but also a very strong crime thriller narrative is built from it, with the murders sort of being built up in a slow burn way, but very effectively. The murders get more extreme as the film goes on, and I think it's really effective from a narrative point of view, but while still being very respectful. There's just one little problem I have with the film. It's way too long. It's way too long. It's 3.5 bloody hours, and you could have shaved at least 45 minutes from this film, and you'd still get a strong story. It does not need to be nearly as long as it is. It's just, it's too long, and you really do feel it. And if it was just shorter, like, I think this film would even struggle to hold the attention of the most patient film fan. It really does drag on, and that's the only thing holding it back from being a truly top tier bit of cinema. What's this? Dan really enjoyed an underrated and less stylized Wes Anderson film? Huh. Who'd have thought that?
What are the odds?
But yeah, nobody seems to really talk about The Darjeeling Limited when talking about Wes Anderson films, which is a shame, because it's one of my favourites, probably because it's a more stripped-back affair and not overly stylized like Life Aquatic was, for example. It's definitely stylized at points. I mean, you've got the funky cinematography, the symmetrical shots, it's nice and vibrant and colourful and kind of has the deadpan humour and whatnot, but it doesn't feel overbearing, if that makes sense. It feels like it's in the realm of reality while still being in Wes's vision, and I think I prefer the more stripped back but still stylized. Like, it's a nice middle ground approach that I personally gel with. But what this film really does have, in comparison to, say, Life Aquatic or Bottle Rocket that I mentioned earlier, is heart and character. You know, it's mainly focused, it's not like a big ensemble like a lot of his other films. It's just focused on the three brothers, Peter, Francis, and Jack, played by Adrian Brody, who's probably my favourite of the cast, Owen Wilson, and Jason Schwartzman, who I thought was really funny. I thought Jason Schwartzman played the role really well. But yeah, I really enjoyed their interactions, and it was genuine. It felt, you know, the nuances in their performances and the sibling dynamic, I thought was really interesting and very believable, and I really connected with their story. I thought it was really enjoyable and heartfelt, and I got into it. I mean, towards the second half of the film, where you have a lot more of the emotional stuff, I think it does hit hard because you care about these three brothers, and just seeing them reconnect was really nice to see. But overall, you still got plenty of good humour. Like, the pepper spray scene always gets me. That's a great scene. I think, yeah, Jason Schwartzman's probably the funniest of the cast, in my opinion. Overall, it's just a nice, cosy, quite underrated film from Wes Anderson, which I never thought I'd be saying. But overall, I'm glad to find some films of his that I do genuinely enjoy and connect with. And that's not even the best of his work yet.
Where's my daughter? Where's my daughter?
Should just say, I haven't seen the second Kill Bill yet. I've only seen the first one so far. And I do feel like my rating could go up, depending on how the second film resolves it. And I do feel like, because obviously it's a two-part film, technically, it's one big story split in half, I feel like my lower rating than most people would give Kill Bill Volume 1, I think it's more down to me not having the full picture yet. I don't know, because I did feel like there was a sense of incompleteness to it. I didn't get the full picture, which naturally I didn't. You know, it's only half of the story. But, you know, I know a lot of other people love this film regardless, and I still really enjoy it. It's very entertaining, but it's honestly not one of my favourite Tarantino films. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's a really entertaining film. You know, fantastic filmmaking from Quentin Tarantino. You know, great homages to classic samurai films and westerns and 70s kung fu movies all put together. I think just really great action scenes, some great filmmaking, great colours. You know, very vibrant film. It's a beautiful looking film. Brilliant shots, brilliant cinematography. The choreography, the fight choreography is great. Some great tension. Like the opening scene with the gun in the cereal box, that was a great moment. I thought that was a great, you know, sequence. And Tarantino is great at doing tension-filled sequences like that. I think in Pulp Fiction, think Glorious Bastards, he's great at that, I think. And the characters are really good. I mean, I think, you know, the bride is a great character. Uma Thurman's fantastic in the film. Oren is sort of a really strong, for this film anyway, a really strong antagonist. I think they both play each other very well. And it's overall like a very entertaining film, but I feel like the main sort of substance, like the emotional anchor that is teased in this film, will get resolved in the second film. As I say, I haven't seen the second film yet. I will. Don't worry, okay?
Go to the city. Find somebody important.
Sunrise is the silent film that I'm studying for my film class, and most of the class weren't really big on it because they're not big on silent films. And usually I'm a bit of a snob, but I can understand because silent movies, they're not for everyone. I totally get that. But for me, I really enjoy silent films, and this is personally one of my favourites because it kind of has it all. Obviously, it's a Hollywood production, so you do have kind of sort of comedic, light-hearted stuff, you know, that are conventional of like American comedies like Buster Keaton films or Charlie Chaplin films, you know, that kind of slapstick silent movie comedy. But also the director, F.W. Murnau, he's obviously a German director and did a lot of German expressionist films, like Nosferatu, for example. So it's kind of a nice hybrid of the two. And now that I have more of an understanding of expressionism and German expressionism, I appreciate what this film does more in terms of the character stuff with the man and his sort of inner headspace and him being tempted by the woman from the city, the kind of allure of the city, the kind of desire. And I, you know, he's a very tormented, conflicted character. And I think the fact that the film is expressionist, has that expressionist angle, it means that even though he does some pretty nasty things towards the start of the film, or at least attempts to, the film teaches you, or at least for me, not to take everything at face value. And I think that's important of understanding this film, personally. I think the directing and the filmmaking for 1927 is phenomenal. Like, genuinely some fantastic tricks they do with the camera and the visuals. I think it's overall really entertaining with the, especially with the city stuff, when the couple are just roaming about the city and there's like the pig scene where the pig escapes and they have to catch it. That's quite a fun little bit of slapstick. And I think that is all balanced out nice with the kind of gothic, more darker undertones of like German expressionism. I think it's all blended together really well. And I think the acting's really good. The man, George O'Brien, I think the actor's name is, I think he was really good at the end of kind of conveying the tortured sort of, yeah, the tortured mindset of like his character. But the wife, though, Janet Gaynor, I think she was probably the standout of the cast, because I think her performance was quite understated, and it felt the most genuine and believable. It wasn't exaggerated, it wasn't heightened mostly. She had like some nice nuances in the performance, and I thought she was the best of the cast. But overall, the film is just a blast for me, and I love it. It's one of my favourite silent movies.
Good morning, Vietnam!
I'm on a bit of a Vietnam movie kick as of late, like in terms of the Vietnam War. I mean, you know, films like Full Metal Jacket, First Blood, and now Apocalypse Now, which the director, Ford Coppola, said, you know, famously, my movie isn't just about Vietnam, it is Vietnam. And I think Francis Ford Coppola in this film creates such an immersive experience, and it almost feels nightmarish, the headspace of this film and the landscape of Vietnam in this film. It's like a very specific nightmare. It's almost surreal in a way, and I think it's beautifully done. I think aesthetically it's one of the most beautiful films I've ever seen. I think the cinematography is stunning, the action set pieces are so well done, the colours are so vibrant and they really pop. The scale of the whole thing, I think, is so well done. But it's also got that nightmarish, dreamlike quality, like the crossfading and just the weird sort of tricks that are played through the film. Even just like simple lighting tricks or sound tricks. You know, the way that the helicopter blades sort of drown out any other sound in a scene. I think it's really clever. And the overall kind of thing of war just consuming everyone in Vietnam, I think it's just so well done through filmmaking. I really love the immersion of this film. I think on the surface, this film does seem like a kind of typical action war film. But honestly, the way that the film kind of depicts this nightmarish tone, it flips those conventions on its head. And, you know, the action scene where Rise of the Valkyries is playing, that typically would be quite an exciting action set piece. For me, I found it kind of disturbing, and I was kind of edge of my seat. I was like kind of uncomfortable, and that's really clever. It's not overt, but it's really cleverly done. I think the characters as well were really strong. I think Willard was quite a strong protagonist, and I really enjoyed watching him, and his descent into just pure madness was quite compelling in a quite a disturbing way. Kilgore, played by Robert Duvall, he is one sadistic bastard, but he's very memorable and very effective in a quite a darkly humorous way. And the build-up of Marlon Brando's Kurt's character, I think, is so effective throughout the film. It kind of has a very off quality, but it works, in my opinion, just about. And I can't really explain it, but it shouldn't work, but it does. All right, let's break out the tier list now. We've got the great movies, we've got the fantastic movies, and now we've got the masterpieces. The top four on this list are all 10 out of 10 masterpiece movies, so it's a tough battle. Starting with after taking a bit of a break from the Dollars trilogy, I finally completed it with The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly this month, and this film eclipses the other two. It's a masterpiece in action adventure storytelling. It's the quintessential spaghetti western film, and just, I can't stress enough just the impact that this film has had on cinema in the nearly 60 years since it came out in 1966. Yes, it's a slow burn, but honestly, the pace is really strong and it never feels like it drags out. The time is used so effectively, because it's this large-scale adventure story in the midst of the American Civil War, which I think is so well done. You know, the battle stuff is phenomenal, the explosions, and just all the battle stuff in the Civil War is great. But it's also intertwined with these personal character conflicts between Blondie, Angel Eyes, and Tuco, our titular good, bad, and ugly. I think they're all brilliant. Blondie and Tuco have a great dynamic with each other, and it's mainly focused on them. Angel Eyes is a very terrifying villain, and his introduction, I can't stress enough how similar that is to the beginning of Inglourious Basterds. Like, Tarantino adores this film. I'm pretty sure he said it's his favourite movie of all time at one point, but you can clearly see the influence of this in his films, for example. But the way all three of the characters are introduced, it's so economical and just so clever, and you know their personalities just immediately. And I also love the themes of morality in westerns, the kind of, you know, outlaws, and it's something that was kind of in Fistful of Dollars, but it's really here, especially with Blondie the Good. He's not really a good person, he's just good at what he does, or he's the best of the bad bunch. There's some great interpretations in that regard, and I just think the morality tale of this is very clever. The any American score as well, it's one of the best film scores ever. You've got the main theme, the iconic main theme. You've got The Ecstasy of Gold, and you've got the music during the final standoff, which is one of the most awe-inspiring climaxes to a film I've ever seen. And it's just a few blokes stood at a distance from each other, just staring each other down. And it is masterful. It is masterful stuff right there. I was about to say, oh, this film doesn't really connect with me emotionally. And yeah, I mean, in comparison to some other films that I've put in the 10 out of 10 category this year, yeah, it probably doesn't. It's not like an emotional gut punch or anything, but there are definitely some emotional scenes, like the part where Blondie comforts the dying soldier with a cigar, and, you know, it's still got heart, it's got soul, and it's just a perfect bit of filmmaking, and everybody should watch it at some point in their life.
Oh, that's sad. That's the saddest thing I ever heard.
I take back any criticism I've ever made about Wes Anderson films not having emotion or heart, because when he really wants to, Wes Anderson can rip your heart out and tear it into little shreds. This film is an emotional tour de force, and it's an absolute just masterpiece. This is without a doubt my favourite Wes Anderson film, and it's not even close, and I doubt it'll even be topped, honestly. I haven't seen Grand Budapest yet, but I doubt it'll top it, because this is everything that I want from Wes Anderson. Yes, it's somewhat stylized, but the characters and the world very much feel anchored in reality, and it's that perfect hybrid of normal movie and stylized Wes Anderson movie. And I do genuinely think it's really great. The cinematography is genuinely beautiful. The symmetry and the colourful costumes and the quirkiness, I think it's essential in this film, because this film is the darkest that he's ever gone. Obviously, with the three Tenenbaum children, you've got Margot, Chas and Richie, you know, Margot's depression, Chas's overprotective nature with his kids after losing his wife, and then Richie, who, let's just say that scene had me in bits. And then you've also got Royal, you know, played by Gene Hackman, who's the father, and how he's an absolute knobhead, but you do see him kind of redeem himself, and it's just good to see kind of that, the sort of reconciliation, particularly with Chas and Royal, you know, that they're definitely the most fractured of the father and child relationships. I've got to say as well, the casting in this film is very out there. Like, a lot of Wes Anderson films have your regulars, you know, your Bill Murray's, your own Wilsons and whatnot, and yeah, they're in this film as well, but you have some very, like, unconventional, you know, you've got Gene Hackman, Danny Glover, Ben Stiller. These are very unconventional picks for a Wes Anderson film, and it makes the performances just feel a little bit more genuine and authentic, and I think all the characters absolutely shine. I can't name them all here, but they really do. The dry humour that's a staple of Wes's films, I've kind of critiqued it with, you know, Life Aquatic. I was like, there's not really a point to it. Here, not only is there a point to having the humour, it's kind of essential with how dark the film gets, but ultimately, you know, the humour allows the characters to see the light in their lives. That sounds really cringy, but the whole point of seeing the light where they can and the good where they can. And that's a genuinely really beautiful thing to witness. And, you know, without going too in-depth, I watched this on an evening where I just felt really, really crap. And it genuinely did cheer me up. Even though it was an emotional tour de force, it really did cheer me up and lift me up. And I think that's a genuinely beautiful thing. And even though it's number three on this list, technically, I would consider it the true number one, because ultimately, it's the top two I have watched before, so they're already well established in my mind. as films I love. And this film is the one that kind of emotionally resonated with me the most. So I take back any criticism I made about Wes Anderson. You did good here, mate. Now, when people consume films, some people just want to be entertained, and some people just want to critically analyse the films. And there's no right or wrong way to watch a film, right? For me, ideally, I want a blend of both, because if a film is just entertaining and nothing more, I don't really remember it. There's nothing much to latch onto. But on the other hand, if a film is very technically well done, but I don't ultimately enjoy it, I don't enjoy it. Films like Bonnie and Clyde or Do the Right Thing are very technically well made, but I don't enjoy them an awful lot. And ideally, I want a blend of having fun and intelligence. And a number two pick has that in spades.
As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a gangster.
Martin Scorsese's Goodfellas is just one of my favourite films of all time. It's absolutely in my top 20 of all films, and I just adore it. It has everything. In terms of a filmmaking standpoint, it has absolutely everything from effective cinematography, lighting, costumes, sets, props, uses of music, uses of sound bridges, the performances of the characters and the writing. It's all there. The scope of it, it's all there. But it is so fun. I mean, the performances are great from Ray Liotta, Robert De Niro, Joe Pesci are amazing. They're iconic. The humour is great, especially from Joe Pesci as Tommy DeVito. It's all brilliant stuff. It has one of the best opening scenes in film that hooks you immediately as soon as Ray Liotta pulls down the boot of the car and says that iconic first line, and the Tony Bennett's Rags to Riches starts playing. The pace of the film, because it's spread over, you know, multiple decades from the 50s to the 80s, it ultimately just breezes by despite being nearly 2.5 hours long. It's perfectly paced, perfect energy, and the, you know, the filmmaking, it all helps to convey the sense that the gangster mobster lifestyle is, it's almost like a fantasy. It's a bit like Apocalypse Now. There's a fantasy, like dreamlike quality to it. It's enticing, it's exciting, but in the second half of the film it devolves as the characters' lives sort of descend into madness and chaos. The filmmaking reflects that, and it becomes a very specific nightmare, and it's so well done, and it's honestly just why I love the film so much. It's the perfect blend of great filmmaking, great technical attributes, but it's a joy to watch. And the fact that my parents love this film, and let me just say that their taste in film is how can I word this, crap half the time, the fact that they love this film is a testament. But it wasn't quite the number one.
Fuck me, it's Shaun of the Dead.
A surprise to absolutely nobody who knows me. Shaun of the Dead tops this list, of course it does. We watched it this time in my film class. It's one of the films I'm studying, and it's probably my favourite of the ones we get to study. It's, you know, I love this film. I've talked about it to death. I would probably watch my 5 Perfect Movies video if you want proper thoughts on this film, because I don't have anything else to add. All I'll say is that watching it in a school academic environment just reinforces the fact that I still think it's probably the most rewatchable film ever, because I can watch it in that environment and still absolutely adore it and still find new things and new hidden details on my 5th viewing of the film. I love Shaun of the Dead. End of. So I hope you enjoyed this video, and this list was quite stacked, really. There was a lot here, a lot of iconic classic films, and even the ones towards the back end of the list were quite entertaining in their own way. But overall, hope you enjoyed the video. What did you watch in November? What do you think of any of these films if you've seen them? What would you recommend to me? Let me know all that in the comments below. And get ready for the final part of these monthly film rankings with the December ranking. So take care, and I'll see you then.